When you walk through fire, you will not be burned. The flames shall not consume you.
I am the Lord your God.
The one who calls you is faithful.
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 And he will do it. Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God above it all. Hallelujah, God unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. A hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain.
Can we give it up for Northwest University Choralons? We are so glad to have them with us this morning. Welcome, Evergreen Church and Waymaker Church is also joining us. It's so good to have you a part of service with us today. Well, my name is Caleb. I'm one of the pastors here. And believe it or not, a while ago, they actually let me go to Northwest University as well. And I graduated there and was able to come on staff here at Evergreen Church. And this school makes such a big difference in this region and in our world because every year they're sending out students, not just into ministry, full-time ministry like me, but into nursing programs, into business, to make a difference in our world because of the faith that they have, the hope that they have, that they can make a difference wherever they go. And I said it to him earlier, but I'm going to say it again. You guys have so much potential. There's so much in store for you, and we here at Evergreen Church are behind you, we are for you, and we are anticipating what God is going to do through you in the years to come. Amen, church? Well, you guys are in for a special treat today. The whole service is by the Choralons, and we even have Dr. Castleberry with us, the president of Northwest University, and we're gonna have a great time together. Are you guys ready? All right, let's go.
Trust the good, the spirit.
Thank you. And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters, that's you, will prophesy. That's what you've just been doing. And your young old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. So what are those days? What are those days? I've been pondering this for a long time. I read a little book called, can't remember the title, but it's about the generational tension that we feel right now. And the author made a profound statement that never in human history have five generations been alive at the same time, except in the book of Genesis, until now, because we all live longer. We've now moved from three generations alive on the planet to five. That's a great explanation for a lot of the social tensions we have today, because we've never had so many people, so many generations alive. And there's a prophecy that in those days, I think these are the days, the demographics are just right. And there's a deep spiritual hunger. You can feel it. This is why we're so curious about what's happening at Asbury, because we want to know, could it happen again? Could awakening happen again? And I believe it can. I believe you're living in those days. I said it before in the first service. Say it again. Pinch yourself to believe that you're alive today, that you get to make a difference, not just for a great college experience, but for the next 40 years of your life of ministry, 60 years of your life of ministry. Speaking of which, such good stuff is happening today. We've filled up all the chairs in the house. So what I need you to do is to look to the center of the row and move to the center. If there's any empty seats, just move to the center. Just move to the center. And by doing that, you're going to make rooms on the edges of the room, of the seats, so more people can fit in. Can you do that right now? Thank you. You guys are so responsive. Thank you. I'm Phil McCallum, pastor here at Evergreen Church. You are so welcome here today. Can you just do a simple little thing? I want to see our church be the most friendly place in Bothell. Could you just turn around and make somebody feel super welcome, and then please have a seat. Just go ahead. Make somebody feel super welcome, and please have a seat. And please be seated. Thank you for being here. Please be seated. And if you're at the back of the room looking for a place to sit, there are four seats up here at the front. There are seats along the edges of the room. You could grab any one of those seats. So glad to have you here. Well, this afternoon, about 6 o'clock, together with Pastor Caleb, I'm going to hop on a plane and go to Israel to minister to our sister congregation, Bet Hillel. They are the only church in the whole of Israel that owns its own building. I mean, just take that in. They own their own building. It took them 7 years to get permission to use the building they already owned. And it's beginning to wrap up. And we're going there to spend time with their staff to encourage them on how to build a healthy team. So Caleb and I will be there. And then we're going to be back next Sunday because we get back on Saturday. This is a really short, intense trip. So pray for us. I was able to spend time this last week with our sister church in Colorado Springs, New Life Church, with Pastor Brady. Pastor Brady's got a chronic cough, and he's unable to preach. He hasn't been able to preach for about 3 months now. Keep him in your prayers. But I networked with all the churches that we relate to around the U.S., very encouraging. And then while I was away, the experts came in who are assessing our wetlands for our bigger property development. So at Evergreen Church, we're in the process of redesigning our entire campus, and this building is going to become a Christian school building, and it's going to be an auditorium underground. It's a pretty crazy development we're working on. And the wetlands study happened this week. All those things I just described were the result of our tithes and offerings at work here at Evergreen. And thank you for sowing into this ministry. And today we're going to take two offerings. First offering is to sow into this house, our tithes and offerings. This is our church home. And then we're going to sow into these students. And the second offering, you're going to see the vision of a place of prayer and worship for these students and generations beyond them that we're going to be part of. But right now we're going to sow into Evergreen Church. So our helpers are going to come up. Thanks to our hosts. Thank you for coming forward. You can give through the Evergreen Church app. You can download that on your phone or go to our website. There are giving boxes at all of the doors. QR code on the screen. You can mail it in. You can deliver it to the office. You can give it into the white buckets, however it is that you want to give today. So, Father, bless these gifts. And I'm praying that as the people sow them, that they will see the seeds begin to grow and they will harvest righteousness from the seeds they're planting, things that will result in healing in their body and reconciliation in relationships and doors of opportunity open and in prosperity coming into their lives. Do them good, Father, through the gifts they give. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thanks so much, host, for passing out those buckets. How about we hear some more of the choir? Would you like that? Yeah. All right. But first, we're going to hear from a great friend of mine. His name is Dr. Joe Castleberry. He is the president of Northwest University. And he's come to inspire us with a vision for the college. Can you warmly welcome him for being here today? Thanks for being here.
Wow, it is so good to be with you today. I've been looking forward to coming to your church for several months now since I met Pastor Phil. We had a meeting. I called and asked if he could meet with me, and I think he was thinking maybe 30 minutes, and we wound up talking for 3.5 hours. And it's amazing when you meet somebody that you have so much in common with and you feel such a kindred spirit with. But you guys are blessed. You've got a great leader here, and I'm blessed because I got a great choir. wonderful to bring this all together. You know, at Northwest University, we've been training ministers of the gospel and training young people for gospel service across a wide range of fields since 1934. And recently, we were looking at our marketing because we've changed marketing directors, and we felt like it was time to change the marketing message for the university. And as we looked across the country here, we see Christian ministries and Christian organizations just drifting. Whether it's sometimes it's Christian relief and development agencies or Christian charities or Christian schools or Christian universities, other kinds of organizations, we see them drifting further and further from the biblical standards and from faith in Christ. And so we decided we want to declare ourselves to the world. To say where we stand. So our new marketing tagline is Jesus first, Jesus always. We've got the answer that the world needs. Why would we choose anything else? And we feel it is such a privilege to be able to train young people for their careers, to follow their calling with that goal in mind, that they should always keep Jesus first in their life. They should always look to him as their first option. You know, putting Jesus first doesn't mean that we take academic things less seriously. It means we have to take them more seriously. Because what we're doing is we're giving our lives to God and work. And it has to be the best thing we can offer him. David said, I would not give to the Lord that which cost me nothing. We believe that a life surrendered to the Lord needs to be a life surrendered to excellence before God. Our mission statement says, we the people of Northwest University carry the call of God by continually building a learning community dedicated to spiritual vitality, academic excellence, and empowered engagement with human need. And that academic excellence thing means something really important to us. When I came to Northwest 16 years ago, I didn't know whether it was good enough academically for my own kids to go there. My oldest daughter was a rising freshman in college. She had already chosen a different college, and we let her go to that one. We didn't know whether Northwest would be a place where our kids would want to go or not. But within a semester, my daughter transferred back to Northwest because she heard what was going on there. She wanted to be part of what was happening. She came back. All three of my daughters graduated from Northwest University. They got a wonderful education, and they're doing wonderfully in life. You know, we're so proud of our students. They perform. every year we get about 20 students will transfer from the University of Washington to Northwest because they get over there to University of Washington and they get into a situation that isn't what they wanted, and they realize they want to be a place, they want to be in a place that puts Jesus first, and they transfer to Northwest. And I always ask them, if I find a student that's transferred from the University of Washington, I say, well, how would you compare the academic standard here to the University of Washington? They always say, always, well, it's a little more rigorous here. You know, we're not taking it easy on them because they're Christians. We expect more of them. And our students every year are getting into Ivy League graduate programs, getting into the best graduate programs in the world. My own son-in-law just got into the University of Virginia Law School. It's ranked number 7th among the law schools in America. They were happy to have a student from Northwest University. Our students do very well at the best universities in the country. Just had one graduate with her PhD in virology from Harvard. She got her start at Northwest doing scientific research in our laboratories, and we've had several go to the very finest universities in the country for microbiology and virology in the last few years. Students at Northwest get a great education, but they get a great education for them to put under the lordship of Jesus Christ and to put Him first in their lives. We're excited about a new project. Well, the truth is we're getting ready for a major capital campaign because we've got to rebuild our campus, and we've got to add new buildings to do all of the things we want to do in excellence before Jesus. We're excited about our medical programs. We just, this next year, are starting a doctor of physical therapy program and a physician's assistant program because physician's assistants are taking over the medical system. You know how that works. But we're getting more and more committed to medical education, healthcare education, business, technology. Our Creatio Institute, our Creatio Center for Media Technology and Design is training people in computer science and user experience design and other technological fields across the economy. We're excited about the future and what we'll get to do. We're going to have to build new buildings to do it. And as we thought about those new buildings, we decided that the most important thing for us to build first was to rebuild our chapel. And Northwest says we're a college with the soul of a church. And I got to tell you, if you were to take a look at our church right now, you'd be worried about our soul. Poor chapel is worn slap out after 60 years of service. If you go over there right now, it looks truly awful. One of our best donors said, it looks like a hillbilly cabin. Tear it down. But he wasn't offering to rebuild it, so. And I don't think we should tear it down. It stands there as a memory of what God has done through generations in the lives of our students. We want to be tied to that past. But we're rebuilding the chapel. And it'll be done by October at least. August, September, we'll be dedicating that new renewed facility. And one of the most exciting things about it is a new prayer room. And I think they're going to put up some slides. That's what the new chapel prayer room is going to look like. It's a prayer room for about 100 students. It'll be open 24/7 for prayer. And we're trusting that that new prayer center is going to reboot the culture of prayer at Northwest. It's going to really create a hunger for prayer among our students like we've never had before. And we're looking forward to that because, you know, we've got to be a center for revival. We just absolutely have to be. Every revival in the history of America has started on a college campus. If you look at the book Campus Aflame by J. Edwin Orr, who's the most important historian of revival of the 20th century, he talks about how every single one of the major renewals in the church and awakenings in the society began among college students. The truth is, young people have to lead revival. If they don't lead it, it won't be theirs. If it isn't theirs, it won't persist for their lifetime. And we need our students today across our universities, across America, to have an experience with Jesus that is so intense and so powerful that it sets the template for the rest of their lives of what they expect from God. And we desperately need a new generation of ministers for the church. We desperately need Jesus to set loose a wave of calling in this generation of young people that they will take their place leading the church. The average age of ministers in the United States has gone up by 10 years over the last 30 years because the last two generations just have not shown up for ministry the way they used to in previous ones. We're in desperate need of an awakening, and we want Northwest to be the place where it begins for the whole Pacific Northwest and for the nation and for the world. And I'll tell you, our students love the Lord. I don't know if you noticed that while they're singing, but they love the Lord. And we want to create a space for them that will it be conducive to them seeking God with all their hearts. And thank you for your help with that. They'll be taking the offering later. You'll be able to contribute to that. Thank you for what you do for Northwest. We hope that you'll become habitual givers to Northwest, but more than that, we hope that you will put us on your prayer list. Even right now, if you have a prayer list on your phone, that's the way I keep mine. I keep it in a prayer app on my phone. If you've got a prayer list, would you write Northwest University in there? Pray for us every day that God would visit us with revival. I said this in the first service. We're all excited and amazed at what's happening at Asbury College, and we thank God for what's going on there. There's an old saying in Spanish, una golondrina no hace verano. It means one sparrow doesn't make it spring. And the fact that revival's happening in one campus or five campuses or 10 campuses across the country doesn't mean that everything's all right and we've got it now. We need to seek God like never before. We've seen the first sparrow, and we want the fullness of spring to dawn. How many have had enough of winter? I've had enough of it, and I didn't appreciate the snow this morning. But I've had enough spiritual winter in America, too. It's time for a brand new spring. Our students are committed to it. Last Monday night, they came together at 7 o'clock and prayed until 1 in the morning, seeking God for an awakening on our campus. Pray with us and trust God that He'll give us great revival in our time. And I'm going to ask Dave Petey to come and speak for just a moment, and then we'll let him sing some more. Dave is the director of the Choralons. Give him a hand.
Thank you, Dr. Castleberry. I just want to get up here and look at all of you because I'm the only one that doesn't get to do it. And we just want to say thank you for having us. Thank you for worshiping with us. People ask me my favorite part of Northwest University. Them. Each one of them. I carry deeply in my heart, and I love each one of them, and I love what God is doing in them. God is going to do many things through them, but I love what God is doing in them. One of the things that God is doing in our campus right now is that, you know, as students draw close to the Lord, new songs are starting to spring up. And, you know, I think we need to make a way for those. We need to make a platform for those. We need to make a way to get them outside of these walls and these doors. And so we have our very first song. That's an original song. We hope someday we'll have many, many songs as part of a Center for Worship Songwriting that we can gift our whole area and then our whole nation and the whole world with. But our very first song was written by this young man, Daniel, right here. And it's not a song about how cool Daniel is. It's a song about our beautiful King. And just, you know, from a heart of worship. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to have Daniel teach it to us, and then we'll all join together in worship. Amen. Thank you.
church, can we sing Jesus?
Every
Paris. Amen. You all can be seated. Well, good morning. My name is Kelsey. I'm a student here at Northwest, as well as a member of the Choralons, and I think I speak for all of us when I say we are so excited to be here this morning to worship with you. Well, I get the opportunity to share a bit of my testimony and how God has been faithful to me. My testimony actually begins with what felt like an unanswered prayer. Ever since I was little, I had a broken relationship with a family member. And since then, I had dedicated every quiet moment, every altar call, every moment of worship to praying over them and praying that God would repair our relationship. A year ago, I sat across from this person to talk about some of the issues that we had been having. And they looked at me and said that they didn't want anything to do with me. And they did not want a relationship with me. I was sad, but more than anything, I was angry. I was angry with God. It felt like He had ignored my prayers. Over the next couple of months, I grew distant from Him. I no longer went to worship nights or chapels or spent moments in prayer. I didn't want to talk to the God who had ignored me. A couple months later, Choralons got the opportunity to go on tour, and we got to sing at a couple churches and Teen Challenge, and it was really wonderful. But if I'm being completely honest, I didn't really want to be there. It felt fake for me to get up and sing about the God that I felt like wasn't listening to me. But one night as we were singing a song that we'll shortly sing for you, and one of the lines is, "And you're weeping and you're rejoicing, He is for you, He is for you, He is for you." And as we were singing that, I felt that God placed on my heart the story of Lazarus in the Bible. If you haven't heard the story, Lazarus was a friend of Jesus, the brother of Martha and Mary, and Jesus gets a notice that Lazarus is sick, nearing the end of his life. So Jesus and his disciples go, and by the time they get there, the family comes to them distraught. They say, "Jesus, you are too late. Lazarus has died." If you have heard the story, you know what happens next is that Jesus goes and he raises Lazarus from the dead. And yes, that is a testament to God's faithfulness. But there's a moment that happens in between. Jesus shows up, the family's distraught, and he goes to Lazarus's tomb. And the next verse says, "And he wept." And he wept. So if you're here today and you feel like you have prayers that have gone unanswered, know that God is with you and he's weeping with you in the moments of grief. God has been moving in such wonderful ways through our choir. And here to share a little bit of her testimony with us is Mia. So if you guys could help me in welcoming Mia.
Thank you, Kelsey. My name is Mia. This is my third year being part of the Choralons. And today I kind of get to share with you guys what's been going on in my life. So since about October, I've been having a lot of health issues. I've always had eczema, but it kind of flared up and it started to cover the majority of my body. And I had pink eye symptoms, my eyes would swell, and I had zero energy. And it lasted for months. And I did a round of steroids and I got better, and then it got worse again. And then I did another round, and right before that, my eyes had swelled so much that I couldn't even drive a car. That lasted for a few days. And then I did another round of steroids. I got better, and then I started to get worse again. And we got some test results back that said that I had mold poisoning. So I had to move out of my apartment, away from all my friends, back into the dorms, and live with a bunch of people I didn't know. All to find out that my apartment was completely fine and it was all for nothing. And then A few weeks ago, I emailed Dave and I said, sorry, I haven't gone to like any practice. I just haven't had the energy to stand for an hour. I can't do it. And he asked to talk to me and I was like, yeah, sure. We didn't schedule anything. I walked into chapel, he pulled me aside and I was like, this is what's going on. And he was like, just come to class and sit in the back. So I came to class and I sat in the back, and about halfway through, he asked some of my fellow friends to come and pray for me. And I sobbed. I cried a lot, and I don't cry in front of people like ever. And nothing happened. And then that was on a Monday. So the following Sunday, I went to church and he talked about healing. And I was like, oh, maybe this is for me. It was not, but that's okay. And he said, sometimes we need healing, but sometimes God doesn't give it, and that's okay. And I remember feeling a sense of hope for once. I knew I wasn't gonna get better, but I knew it wasn't the end. And that was something to rejoice about. I went on with my day, and I went thrifting with some friends, which was really fun. And then I got back to my room to try on some of the clothes I had got. And I looked in the mirror, and I used to have this giant red rash that covered my entire chest, and it was completely gone. I wasn't completely healed. I mean, if you're looking at me right now, I probably don't look great, but that's okay. And as I went along, or went about the day and went about the week, I suddenly had more energy, and I was able to go to class and to stand and praise the Lord with my friends. And I'm not completely better. We don't really know what's wrong. But I have energy to like go about my day, and I'm just significantly better. And I'd been on medication for a while, and for some reason it started working. Don't really know what's going on, but yeah, that's about it.
In your weeping and in your rejoicing, He is for you. He is for you. He is for you. If you could all stand. We came today expectant for God to move. So we have students from the choir who would love to come and pray with you in your moments of grief, in your physical ailment. We're praying for a miracle. We're praying for God's comfort and for God's presence over your life. You don't need to wait for the music to start. You can come get prayer now. But worship with us as we go into this next song.
a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children, may his favor be upon you. And a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children, may his favor be upon you.
That's the word. See, glory is not just a pretty sunrise or sunset. It's what you're feeling right now. It's the atmosphere of heaven touching earth. What that means, when you and I get to heaven, you're going to feel love as you have longed for all your life, as you have imagined possible, because God put that desire within you. And in heaven, you're going to feel in one moment loved, secure, never alone, not afraid. You'll have no self-esteem issues. You're just, all your hang-ups are going to be gone. Everything. It's, you have no idea how free you're going to be, because you're going to be so loved, so loved, so loved. It's absolutely secure. But the glory means you don't have to wait till heaven. You can have that right now. So we've been watching with a lot of interest what's happening in Asbury. What's happening? It's the glory coming down. You don't have to get on a plane and go to Kentucky. You can experience it right here, right here. So it's just a choice to say, Lord, send your glory. And it's that choice to live in his presence, to follow his presence. I'm just so stirred. So I'm listening to these students worship. A lot of things are going through my head. And I'd like the production guys, could you put that slide up of the prayer room? Because I want you to see that again. Because that prayer room, that's what really gets me. That right there. When I was studying to be a lawyer. I had no intention ever to be a Christian pastor, ever. My goal was to make a lot of money, and God spoke to me and said, I don't want your money, I want you. And there was a prayer room at our Christian university where my father taught. I grew up across the street, and I'd never gone there. But I went there and I experienced the presence of God. I was all by myself. And my friends and I had gone to this football game, and we were all supposed to go out to eat. And I said, we can't go out and eat. God's like in that room. We have to go there. And then we started fasting and praying every Friday. One of my friends that was in that group, we prayed together for 7 years straight. He was going to be a sports radio announcer, and I was going to be a lawyer, but he became pastor of the same church and the University of Kansas campus, and I've been here and many other places. But all started out that prayer meeting, and you guys need that prayer room, and generations yet to come at Northwest University need that prayer room, and much, much more. I'm inviting us as a whole group to sow into Northwest University, and this isn't just about an offering. I'm encouraging you to put your heart into one of the most important things happening in the city of Seattle, in fact, the whole Pacific Northwest region. Imagine life without Northwest University. Imagine how many churches wouldn't have pastors, how many businesses wouldn't have leaders. And in our particular dark part of the world, how many pinpoints of light would be missing in the world? They all emanate out of this one university. And I think it's more than just giving money. I think we need to renew our heart for the university. I actually want to speak right now to parents who have little kids, because right now, maybe you got that little college fund going and you're thinking about, you know, what Ivy League school your kid could go to. You could send your kid to an Ivy League school and their heart be totally lost to Jesus and the kingdom, because that shows where all the stats show all of that. And maybe have a different viewpoint that a Christian education for your kids in an environment like this is going to change their forever. And the first step could be sowing into an offering like this. My parents came to us kids. We were grown. And at this point, my parents owned two houses. And it was a total miracle that that ever happened in their life. And they said, we want to give away one of our houses to the university. It was a Christian university, to build the chapel. I didn't tell you that story. So my parents gave an entire house away. And in that chapel are five rows of seats named after me and my brothers and sisters. What I know is that chapel is changing lives today. And I think Northwest University needs a great place of prayer, a great place of worship. And we're going to sow into that today. You can do that through the Evergreen Church app. There's in the list of giving categories, one says there, Northwest University. So the first thing that will happen with this offering is make sure all the choir expenses are covered. It's about $4,000. But everything beyond that, we want to sow into the building fund. So the president gave me a challenge, and we're going to take it as a church to give $25,000 as a congregation into this fund. And we're just going to believe and help make this happen. And it gets better We're one of 10 churches, so there's 9 other churches also giving $25,000. And then there's a major donor who's going to match that, so it all gets doubled, so our 25 becomes 50. So, like, this gets better and better. And you could help sow into that. And we want to give a gift to all the students. We at Evergreen Church have been part of a movement. It's called Awakening Northwest, and it's a, not the university, it's about awakening worship in our city. Brock Sabo, wherever you are, Brock. Oh, back there in the back. Thank you, Brock. Has been envisioning of this. So here's the dream. You ready? Within the next 5 years, we're actually into year 4. In the next 5 years, we will have tens of thousands of Christians worshiping Jesus at the Gorge. So the guys who are responsible for booking the Gorge and Climate Pledge Arena, all the big things they brought, Maverick City and all that, plus all the secular artists to Seattle, these guys have a vision to see the Gorge filled again with believers worshiping Jesus in great number. So they're taking baby steps toward tens of thousands. They have booked out the big hockey rink in Kent at the Showwear Center, and it's going to happen at the end of April. I think it's the 28th, and there's all kinds of bands there. It's a true music festival. Well, ultimately, the dream is to have it at the Gorge, and you're all going to get 2 free tickets, okay? 2 free tickets, everybody in the choir. And then all the production people at Northwest, you all get 2 free tickets so that you can be part of that. And I want to say thank you to Brock for making that happen. Brock, by the way, is a real estate agent who just does all this stuff for free for Jesus because he has such a passion to see it happen. Well, ushers, come on up to the front. We're going to receive a special gift for the university. You can make out your checks to Evergreen Church, and we'll, of course, make sure 100% of that gets to Northwest. So, Father, bless this gift that we give. Let it be exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask, think, or imagine. Not even incremental, but I pray, Father, for something large and profound that will just take us hugely forward. Bless our pastor, Dr. Castleberry, and the work he's doing in the university. And Lord, I pray that you would expand the work according to the vision that you put within his heart. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, a couple of things are going to happen. The choir are going to sing one last song, put a song of praise in our hearts. Second thing is, I'm just looking at the time. Dads and moms, if one mom or one dad could go and get your kids out of kids' care, that would be a huge blessing to our volunteers who are serving there. Could you do that? All right, choir, let's sing.
Amen. We serve a faithful God. So you may not know this song, but if you would just worship with us, he's worthy of our praise and he's faithful. Oh,
joy in the dark.